Good morning. I have a few announcements for you today. First, I wanted to invite everyone to Alpha. Alpha starts this Tuesday at 6:30. If you're not familiar with Alpha, Alpha is the first letter of the Greek alphabet. And what it is the beginning. For all of us to go back to the beginning of our faith. Who is Jesus? What does it mean to be a Christian? And how would I respond to those questions? It's hard to defend the Eucharist if you don't even know how to talk about Jesus. And so I invite you to come. It's also a great way to bring a friend. Hey, I can invite you to dinner. Come to dinner at 6:30. You don't have to commit to all summer. Just come this week. And if you have questions, I would love to talk to you about it. I'll be in the back of the church after Mass. Invite friends for dinner. Also, this week is the Wadena County Fair here in town, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Some years, Father Aaron has spent many, many hours a day at the fair. This year, he's not sure he can commit to very many hours, and so he needs more of our help at the fair. And so we're looking for parishioners to take a two-hour shift, or many two-hour shifts. I also have the sign-up for that in the back as well. Also, today we have Sister Obina here to share about her mission work, and there will be a second collection. Also, if you want to meet Sister Obina or spend some more time with her, connect with me after Mass. She's actually staying at my house, and so we'd love to connect, especially young women, with her. Next weekend, Deacon Jerry will be retiring from serving as a deacon here in our parishes, and we will have a celebration thanking him for his 90 years of service at noon here at St. Anne's. And also, beginning July 4th weekend, our parishes will have a new Mass time. So this Mass will switch to 10 a.m., and that is also when the bishop has reinstated the obligation to attend Sunday Mass. And so I invite you to please stand for our opening.
Thank you. Dear brothers and sisters, we are now back into ordinary time and it's full flourishing, and we hear about the parable of the seeds that are sown and how they grow into this great plant, and how Christ in our own life nourishes us, gives us life, and we grow secretly throughout the world as faithful people, helping God's kingdom to become enfleshed. And dear brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you come to heal the souls of the contrite. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you forgive the sins of the sorrowful. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you plead for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I too will take from the crest of the cedar, from its topmost branches tear off a tender shoot, and plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain heights of Israel I will plant it. It shall put forth branches and bear fruit, and become a majestic cedar. Birds of every kind shall dwell beneath it, every winged thing in the shade of its boughs. And all the trees of the field shall know that I, the Lord, Bring low the high tree. Lift high the lowly tree. Wither up the green tree, and make the withered tree bloom. As I, the Lord, have spoken, so will I do. The word of the Lord. A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, we are always courageous, although we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yet we are courageous, and we would rather leave the body and go home to the Lord. Therefore, we aspire to please Him, whether we are at home or away. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense according to what he did in the body, whether good or evil. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
It is as if a man were to scatter seed on the land, and would sleep and rise night and day, and through it all the seed would sprout and grow. He knows not how. Of its own accord, the land yields fruit, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. And when the grain is ripe, he wields the sickle at once, for the harvest has come. He said, to what shall we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable can we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, that when it is sown in the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. But once it is sown, it springs up and becomes the largest of plants and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the sky can dwell in its shade. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to understand it. Without parables, he did not speak to them, but to his own disciples, he explained everything in private. Gospel of the Lord.
As Victoria mentioned at the beginning of Mass, we're very blessed to have Sister Obina here from Nigeria. She traveled all the way from Texas. She's been living in Texas, but she represents the sisters, the daughters of Mary, Mother of Mercy. They have places all over the world. I don't want to steal too much of her stuff, but we're very excited to have her talk with us after communion today about the mission and what they do. It's pretty fitting, actually, that she's here this particular Sunday with the readings that we have. Remember how last weekend I was very excited and running all over the place in the sanctuary trying to get everybody's attention about the blood of Jesus, the body of Jesus, and how Jesus is right here and how awesome it is. Think about now what God is doing. Every Saturday night, beginning in the Far East, Australia, Japan, going all the way through country by country, in every country of the world, the Catholic Church is present. Ever since the time of Jesus, the Catholic Church has been spreading country by country, location by location, and now, on Saturday nights, all the way through Sunday evening, our time, going all the way out to Hawaii, all throughout the world, people are celebrating Sunday Mass. And Jesus is appearing in word and in sacrament everywhere in the world. At the time of Jesus, when Jesus showed up, remember the Jewish people now, they knew that they were selected by God as a people to be God's light in the world, to be God's presence, his chosen people, so that the whole world could look at them and say, I want to be like that, I want to follow God, and the whole world would be transformed by him. God loves the world so much, he sends Jesus, his son, for 30 years. It's sort of, I just try to find things in my own life where they match up. I try to think of like a spy movie. You ever watch spy movies? Maybe boys like spy movies more than girls do, I don't know. Spy movies where, you know, the spy infiltrates and lives in a foreign country for years. They might live there for decades. And then suddenly the spy starts doing their work in conquering over the government and taking it over, step by step by step by step. In some regards, the people of the Jewish tradition at the time period, they were waiting for the Messiah. They were living under the oppression of the Romans. They were occupied by the Romans. And just like the Germans, the Nazis, moved through and took over territories of Europe during the Second World War, First World War, Second World War, they started taking over and oppressing these other nations, particularly I think of like Poland, how they were taking over and they were occupying the territory, and they had to be liberated. And so the Jewish people were expecting the Messiah to walk in and liberate them from the occupation of the Romans, so that they can live a free life to worship God without any hindrance. And Jesus is like this spy who has been put into on the earth and into the people. And for 30 years, he walks around in Nazareth, and they don't even know that he's there. And during that time period, he's growing into his full maturity as a human being. And then he begins his 3-year ministry. And he starts telling stories and parables like the one that we heard today about the seed that being planted and about the mustard seed that grows into the big bush. And we know that during his 3 years, he starts teaching about what heaven is like. And they're expecting Jesus to become this big rebellion and overthrow the Romans and take over and establish this nation state. That's not what happens. Moment by moment, person by person, God's kingdom keeps spreading to person, to person, to person, to person, to person. And it's been spreading like a plant that's been seeded and then watered and grown. We don't know how it happens, but it just keeps spreading all throughout the planet to the present day, 2,000 years later. So now Jesus is still working his miracle of bringing his presence to every person that wants to meet him. And here we are. You and I are encountering Jesus in word and in sacrament in the same way. The power of Jesus. Now you're going to hear some pretty incredible stories from the sister, so I'm going to save them for her, but to understand that this is how Jesus works. He's not going to expect us to rise up as Catholics and overthrow the government and we're going to make the whole world Catholic. Think that's what we're supposed to do? No, that's not what we're supposed to do. But Christ is moving person by person, bringing his message of freedom and salvation. I want your soul. I want you to know me and my love. I want to be present to you, for you to learn the teachings that I have, God's way of heaven, because one day I want you to be in heaven with me. And so, for us to appreciate this, some of the things that Sister does is working with the orphans, working with those who have been abandoned and lost and not they were rejected by their own people. And it's life-threatening. She's going to tell you maybe about some of the sisters in her own community. Yesterday she was over at St. John's. She was outside walking through the cemetery before Mass and praying. She looked at her email and found out some of her own sisters in Nigeria yesterday, they don't know where they are. Very likely kidnapped, captured in a territory where to be Catholic, to be a person of faith, is life-threatening. There are places in the world in the present day where to celebrate Mass, to represent Jesus, to wear an outfit like sister wears or like the priest wears, it's forbidden or it's life-threatening. You can be killed over it. Genocide over Christian belief. And so there are places even now in the present day where priests are sneaking into people's homes on Sundays to celebrate Mass in quiet, hoping not to get caught. They show up looking just like everybody else, and the family has a Mass kit hidden away, and they celebrate Mass in their home, and then they all go back their own way. Or in Sister's case, they take care of orphans and refugees and any of the children that are sent to them, any of the mentally handicapped people that are brought to them, they take care of them. And because they're changing the culture and they're doing God's work, their life is threatened. So we must never take for granted what God is doing. Like the perfect spy, he is entering into every territory, changing hearts, my heart. May I be transformed by him. Today we're going to meet him in all the places in the whole wide world. God is going to be present right now. right here in the Eucharist. And do I appreciate that? Do I allow that seed to grow, I don't know how, in my faith? And to allow that to blossom into a bigger extension of faith so that other people can rest in that faith. They can look at me and go, I want to be like them. And even maybe there'll be a point in our own lives where we are asked to be kidnapped for our faith, to die for our faith, to have our blood soak the soil of our faith, so that others will look and say, that person loves Jesus so much they will die for him. I want to be like that too. To follow Jesus all the way through the cross to the resurrection and the glory of heaven. That we say, it's on page 27 in the blue book, following the words. This creed we've been saying since the 300s. There are people who die over their belief in this creed. So for us to appreciate the worship that we offer in these words that we say, page 27. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit, incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, throughout the summer. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
love us so much that you sent your Son Jesus into our world to walk with us, teach us your ways, and prepare us for heavenly life with you. May we now and always appreciate him being present to us. We ask these prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May your heart accept the sacrifice in your hands
for the praise and glory of his name,
for our good and for all the holy church.
O God, who in the offerings presented here provide for the twofold needs of human nature, nourishing us with food and renewing us with your sacrament, grant, we pray, that the sustenance they provide may not fail us in body or in spirit, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the third Eucharistic prayer that I'll be using, just notice those moments when it talks about the whole world being gathered together, and the peace that God brings, the unity that God brings us in the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his Paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works. For you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
By the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress,
as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us exchange with one another the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be.
Thank you. As this reception of your Holy Communion, O Lord, foreshadows the union of the faithful in you, so may it bring about unity in your church through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. We have a couple of different things today. Please, sister, come on up. First, we're going to have Sister Obina talk, and then we'll be doing a second collection. After Sister is finished speaking, we'll have a collection to help raise money for the mission that they're doing as sisters throughout the world to help support some of their programming that they do. And then after that, we've got a 70th wedding anniversary. 70.
Okay, good morning.
Oh, yeah, it's all yours.
Good morning. Immediately I walk into this church, I go, wow, this is a beautiful church. It's like one of those churches you find in the ancient city of Rome. It's really a basilica. It's beautiful. Thank you so much, Father Aaron, to allow me to worship with you in this beautiful church this morning. And help me to thank Father Aaron, too, that yesterday he had to drive more than 2 hours to pick me up from the airport. That is really very remarkable. I appreciate that sacrifice. Thank you so much, Father. My name is Sister Obina Mola. I belong to the Congregation of the Daughters of Mary, Mother of Mercy. I'm originally from Nigeria, but I live in Texas. I have been a nun for 28 years, and I became a nun at the age of 20. And being a nun is the best thing that has ever happened to me. I love it. I am the mission coordinator for my order, Daughters of Mary, Mother of Mercy, in the North America. It is tough, it's such a tough job to do because it entails speaking and begging for money. But what moves me to do what I do is my deepest love for the poorest of the poor that we minister. My congregation was founded in 1961 by late Bishop Anthony Mwego of Holy Ghost Congregation. Since the inception of my congregation, we have spread out a lot. We are in Nigeria, we are in Cameroon, we are in South Africa, we are in Lesotho, we are in Ghana. And in Europe, we are in Sweden, we are in Italy, we are in Australia, Austria, Ireland, and England. And in North America, we are in the United States of America. Canada. As Mercy Sisters, we establish orphanages for thousands of children that we shelter, feed, clothe, educate, evangelize, and protect the poorest and most vulnerable. This includes unwanted newborns left to die amid debris, abandoned babies, dumped alongside of the road, and the fortunate ones who are deposited by our doorposts. And then there are even pregnant ones who do not know what to do with their lives, and all they can do is just to hide away. And sometimes they deliver those babies and put them along the dumpster in a box and just run away because their families will reject them. And what we sisters do is to pick up those babies and bring them inside their orphanages and care for them from day one till they're able to be on their own. So most of the orphans we have, they are picked up. Either they are dropped by a doorpost, or we pick them along the roadside, or by the dumpster. And we give them basic needs, shelter, food, clothes, and education. We have different not-for-profit schools that we have established to make sure that these kids at least they know how to write their names, read, and have basic education. And one of the challenges that we found in doing this is it's not easy to maintain these kids up until they are able to be on their own. So my job as a mission coordinator in my order is to apply to different dioceses and see which diocese we ask us to come and talk about your mission. So whatever you contribute here will be geared towards alleviating the pains of these orphans and the handicapped that we take care of. Now, things you take for granted in the United States of America is not found among these kids. Something like water, if they are 6-7 years old, they are ready to pick up their bucket and they go to the stream and fetch water. So we are trying to see a way that we can dig a well in each of our orphanages to give them at least clean water to drink and to cook and to bed. And about $5,000 we provide five wells in five of our orphanages. And then we do also have clinics that take care of their health when they are sick. And some of those clinics roofs have fallen apart. And it imposes a huge challenge to fix them and to continue with the work that we do. It will take another $7,000 to fix those roofs. So some of these facilities are temporarily closed because they cannot provide safe and sanitary services for the services that we do. So I have to move around and speak to parishes and ask for help so that we will continue to do what we do. Lives are meant to be preserved at all costs. And so we try as much as possible to give these vulnerable ones we take care of quality lives as much as we can, so that they won't see themselves as a cost of being human beings or less human beings, because either their parents cannot provide for them or they were born and thrown away and rejected. The joy of it is that we have seen a lot of God's hand work in them through us, because some of them eventually they grow up being independent, able to take care of themselves and others. Some of them have gotten married, some of them become nuns and priests. So that's the joy of it, that we do not allow all these vulnerable ones to waste their way, like they don't belong or they are different, or it's a cost to be born poor or wretched. Father was talking about our sisters that are being kidnapped in Nigeria. That is true. If you actually go online, you see a lot happening in Nigeria. Genocide going on right now. We have a Muslim president whose agenda is to Islamize the whole country. And I happen to come from the southeast, that the population is 98% Christians. And he doesn't want that. So he has established Boko Haram and all kinds of terrorist groups to go down the south and get all the Christians killed. So my family woke me up last night around 3 a.m. because I've been trying to reach them and see how they are doing. And they called me and said, "We are here." I said, "Where are you?" They gathered in one place, they are praying, they are hearing gun shooting and all that. "Are you okay? Why are you in one place?" And they said they want to die together. So it's like you wake up every day, you do not know what to expect. And there have been a lot of parents that are being shot, and we have to take care of the kids if we're able to grab them. And we make sure that they feel safe wherever they are. That's exactly why I am here today, to speak with you, to help us to help continue to minister to this vulnerable one, that without us, there is basically nothing they can do. And there are some kids that have been thrown away. If we don't see them on time, they die. So blessed are really those that you are able to find and protect them until they are able to help themselves. Thank you for having me this morning, and I appreciate your kindness and your welcome. Thank you, and God bless you.
Can some of the ushers from the group go around? We'll be doing a second collection now here specifically to help the sisters in their mission, the Daughters of Mary, Mother of Mercy, as they go up through the world taking care of the orphans. They want to make a well. That's one of the things they want to do at each of their 5 orphanages. And they also want to be able to repair the roofs of those orphanages. So our generosity will be able to help them with that today. Sisters going around all through the United States over the next number of months here, through the summer months, trying to be able to raise money for that. So what will happen is all the money will be collected, and then we will be writing a check. It'll go through our mission office in our diocese and then be directly to the sisters. That way, sister doesn't have to carry large piles of cash through the airport. They'll think she's a spy. No. She can just bring a check or get a check, and it'll work out well. So thank you for your generosity that way. You can see the Catholic Church throughout the world, the Christians that are present throughout the world, it's not easy to be Christian. We might be getting used to, unfortunately, having a decline of Catholicism here in the United States, where we see numbers going down, but most of the world is growing. The Catholic Church is, I think, 1.2 billion people. It's a lot of people, and it's just growing throughout the world. So our financial help in their ministries and what they're doing is really, really helpful. One or two other announcements here. We are also hiring for a business administrator for all 8 of our parishes. We want to be able to take the administrative burden off the priests and be able to have the priests get out as much as possible. Father Gabriel and myself, with our 8 parishes coming together. So we are hiring a full-time business administrator. We are also hiring a full-time and a part-time directors of discipleship, faith formation. Those positions are in addition to all of the faith formation directors that we have at all of the parishes. We're going to be calling them directors of discipleship, so each parish will still have a part-time discipleship director, but then we also want to have a full-time and a part-time that cover all 8 to be able to share some of our ministries together. So those 3 positions, business administrator and 2 full-time and a part-time discipleship director's positions, those are all available, and you can talk to me about those anytime until those positions are full. We are blessed. Nick and Pat Schmitz are celebrating 70 years of being married together. So I'd like to be able to offer a blessing for you. Is that okay? We're going to show all the people at home that you really exist. There's about 150 million people watching. Okay, so we'll offer a blessing for you. Do you feel up to standing up so they can all see you? All right. 70 years, way to go. Wow. Let us pray. Lord God and Creator, we bless and praise your name. In the beginning, you made man and woman so that they might enter a communion of life and love. You likewise blessed the union of Nick and Pat that they might reflect the union of Christ with his church. Look with kindness on them today. Amid the joys and struggles of their life, you have preserved the union between them. Renew their marriage covenant. Increase your love in them.
and strengthen their bond of peace, so that surrounded by their children, they may always rejoice in the gift of your blessing. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Congratulations on the 7th year. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your lives.
Thanks be to God. Sister Obina will be out at the main entrance up there shaking hands with us, okay? So if you want to be able to meet with her and talk with her. And if anybody else has any celebrations of their life that they want to be able to pray about, will be available out there after Mass.
Thank you. See you later.
Yeah, which is